So another important thing that we can look at related to second moment of inertia, in fact, for several other things this applies to, is the parallel axis theorem. And so basically what we've done before is whenever we did this, when we did this derivation, we assumed that we were starting in the geometric center. And what we did is we took an area, a D area. Yay! So we had a D area. And it was fantastic. We were super excited. And we said that there was a D force that was applied. And we established that the D force was dependent upon its distance from the center. And that we could say that DF, and if you're like, what is she talking about? You should go watch that video because it's super awesome, is dy d area. Okay. And then we said, okay, so everything is a distance y away. So if I want to sum up all the moments, I could take the integral of y times df, except that df is equal to and then we had this, and you're like, yay. Okay. So anyway, we've already established that that's like a thing. Okay. So that was based around the centroid. Now the thing is it doesn't really matter if we are doing this around the centroid, actually. So actually nothing about this at all says, so this is actually totally fine. This would give me the polar moment about the x-axis for anywhere that I actually put the x-axis, which is fine. Except sometimes we wish we knew something that wasn't around the centroid, and not for like any, well, for physical reasons, but I'll get to that in a minute. But let's just pretend that we moved, let's just pretend that we moved this. So let me get a little bit more specific. I'm going to say that y is going to go from some y min. Oh, that was bigger than I meant it to be. So from some y min to some y max. Okay. And so we're just assuming that this was around the geometric center. All right. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new, axis. I'm going to create a new axis here. And so all of these that I did, I'll say, well, I did that for around the geometric center. Now I want to calculate this around mx. Okay, so you're like, okay, so m about my new x, and we'll make it x tilde, just so it's super duper different, x tilde. And well, how much did I move this? I've moved it some delta y. All right, so now when I used to have, and I'll actually move this back up for a second, I used to have, and I'll mark these. I'm running out of space. This is terrible. This was y max, and this was y min. And that was all kind of in the context of this this blue line. I'll switch this line to green. All right, and so this is going to be in the context of all the green stuff. So now delta, or this y max, is actually its new value. Since I've already moved this up, this is shorter, right? So this is going to be now y max minus delta y. And this one over here is actually further away. And then down here on the bottom, this would be y min minus another delta y. And so then that means that our little axis-y theorem-y thing, instead of being, so this is the tilde version, instead of being y squared dA going from y min to y max, it's going from y min minus delta y to y max minus delta y, like that. All right, and so we can actually, it's probably a little bit simpler to do kind of a basic substitution. And so I'm gonna call it y tilde just for a second, I'm gonna let it be, I'll do it in green since apparently colors matter. So I'm gonna let y tilde be equal to y plus delta y, which is how much I was moved. And so that means if I'm gonna do my new y max, my new y, whatever, the top of the integral, my new upper limit is going to be basically y max by itself. And my new lower limit is just going to be y min by itself because of, you know, substitution. And essentially all I've done is I've shifted the indices on the summation. But essentially now I still have the same thing. So I have ix is going to be equal to y plus delta y quantity squared dA, and then this y min and then y next. And you're like, yeah, but I don't see that you've made any progress. Okay, so just trust in the math, it's gonna get there. All right, so I have y min, y max, and y squared plus 2 delta y times y plus delta, and you can't see what I'm doing anymore, squared dA. All right, okay, so there you see that. All right, and I'm gonna separate these out into y min and max. Okay, and I'm gonna stop writing y min and y max because it's just back to the regular integrals that I was always going to have. So da-da, dA plus da-da, dA, and then da-da, dA. All right, yay, we're making progress. You can't really tell, but I swear we are. Okay, clearly we're making progress because this is just that. All right, now delta y, remember, is just a constant, so I can bring it outside the integration. And then this is also a constant, so I can bring it outside the integration. Okay, now this is gonna maybe seem a little hand-wavy to some of you that aren't particularly comfortable with geometric centers, but remember that essentially what we did is we shifted back down to the geometric center. So if I have something here, and I'm at the geometric center, and I just take y times dA here, and then I add up all the y's times the dA's here, essentially what I'm getting is the centroid, and this is going to come out to zero because that's the whole point of the centroid, is that my area is equally distributed on both sides of that axis, okay? Maybe, yes, because this is a moment, right? And if I'm at the center, then I should have an equal moment of area, first moment of area, not second moment of area, but I should have an equal first moment of area on both sides of the centroid, so this is gonna go to zero. Specifically, I'm gonna say this again, because it's the centroid. So since it's a centroid, the area should be equally distributed on both sides of it. And so if I'm gonna add everything up and then subtract everything off, and because again, this is y, so the ups would be positive, the downs would be negative, and that's gonna come out to be zero. Okay, so now I'm just gonna rewrite this. So I have ix plus zero. Okay, so then I have delta y squared, like this, and then the area under the curve of just integral dA is just going to be the area, okay? And so what that means, so if I want to move my axis that I'm looking at, I just have to take the original at the center, add how much I've moved, square it, and multiply by a, okay? So it should look pretty similar, and you should just remember there's that y squared dA sense, and so that still kind of looks like y squared dA. But you also have to remember that this is always the smallest. So that ix is always gonna be the smallest value, and that's specifically because it's the easiest to bend around the neutral axis. So if I'm moving away from that neutral axis, it's just going to be harder. Now, in fact, not only is it gonna be harder, it's never actually going to happen. The only time we're going to use the parallel axis theorem is in composite bodies. And by composite bodies, what I mean is we might have, you know, a beam that's cross-section looks something like, you know, for some reason, maybe it looks like this. So essentially what I would do is I would find Ix through here, and then I know that the center, we'll just pretend that this is the actual center of mass of, I'll put it in the center here, so it'll be a little bit better. So let's pretend I had some kind of weird barbelly thing. So if I had these three bodies, essentially what I would do is I would find this guy because I know that the center of the whole part is here, okay? So I would find the center of this one on its own and then move it to the center. The guy in the middle, his center's already there, and then I'd find this one eventually, and then I'd move it over here. So the idea of the moment around is like some kind of random x-axis really doesn't make any sense, except in this case I was doing it in y because I'm just not paying attention. That doesn't really make any sense. The only way that it makes sense and the only way that we use it is whenever we're going through a centroid. But we would use this in composite bodies to find a weird shape by basically taking a weighted average of the other shape. So that's when the parallel axis theorem comes into play. Not because specifically you would be doing this, and like using that value in a calculation, you would be using that value as an intermediate value to get somewhere else. And so again, we do have the same thing for the other two. So I have that Iy would be Iy at the center plus the perpendicular x distance. A, and then the same thing for R, and again it being the perpendicular distance for the J. And honestly, for that one, I probably just find the X tildes and the Y tildes and add it together. And that was if you were going off to some funky axis. So anyway, the whole idea of the parallel axis theorem is that you can, again, not really use it on its own, but that you can use it in cohorts with other parallel axis theorems to find the I sub X around a more complicated structure. And where people tend to get this confused is they forget in the application of this that this one here, I'm going to say again, is always the smallest. So this, if you get, you know, a central value of like 6, and then over here you're like, oh, so I do some work, and so this turns out to be 3. You're like, no. You probably switch them in the actual calculations. So because you have a value, and then you add a positive, right? Y squared is always going to be positive. Area is always going to be positive. So if you have a number that's always positive and you add more values that are always positive, you're going to get a bigger positive value. So that's the one place when people tend to mess this up. And again, the idea of the parallel axis theorem isn't that it has like an actual use. Like I wouldn't use the results of a parallel axis theorem immediately, but I would use it in the process of finding the second moment of area of a more complicated structure. And then I could do more fun stuff related to bending and torsion.